Scott, you have penned a fantastic piece on your Substack that really encapsulates not just what happened over the weekend, but putting it into a much broader geopolitical and historical scope of the significance of what we all just witnessed over the weekend, Scott. It's still sinking in for a lot of people. And I don't think people, not everybody anyway, really appreciates the gravity of what just happened and how it, in a way, resets the Middle East, the power distribution in the Middle East. Firstly, I just want to get your reactions to what happened over the weekend, Scott, how you're processing this. And I want to talk about what might happen next. But if you could share your thoughts with us about April 14th.
Sure. There's a couple of things. First of all, to put it in perspective, prior to April 14th, Israel operated under the concept of or the belief of that Israel had undisputed deterrence domination, that basically Israel operated in a universe where Israel could do anything it wanted against anybody and nobody was allowed to retaliate against Israel. And a key aspect to the Israeli belief was, one, the notion of their military supremacy, part of which was guaranteed by the assurances of the United States that Israel would possess technological supremacy over any potential enemy. And two was the assurance of American assistance, that America would never abandon their Israeli ally, that through thick and thin, America would be there standing side by side with Israel. What happened on April 14th is, first and foremost, the concept of Israeli and indeed American technological supremacy was punctured. This balloon was punctured by Iran, which, and to put this in a perspective, let me describe the Nevatim Air Base as such. The most heavily protected space on the planet when it came to ballistic missile defense. There was no other place on the planet that was more heavily protected than Nevatim Air Base. It had not just an American X-band radio, radar, the ANTPY-2, but this was connected to the Ballistic Missile Defense Organization hierarchy. So it had advantage of the totality of the American Ballistic Missile Defense Organization's satellite coverage, connectivity, computation capabilities, et cetera. This was linked into air defense assets, Israeli, the Arrow 2, the Arrow 3, Improved Patriot, David Sling, and American Improved Patriot, and the THAAD capability. THAAD was specifically designed to work in concert with this ANTPY-2 X-band radar. All of this was geared to only one threat, the Iranian medium-range ballistic missile threat. That's it. They weren't distracted by anything else. They were only in place to defend Nevatim Air Base from the Iranian medium-range ballistic missile threat. In addition to this hierarchy, the United States incorporated two other layers. One were fighter aircraft, the F-35, F-15s, that were also linked into the BMDO, the Ballistic Missile Defense Organization's hierarchy. So they were gathering data using radar data, et cetera, feeding in more inputs into this hierarchy to increase the level of lethality. And then two, at least two Aegis-class destroyers that were ballistic missile defense system variants, meaning that they've been optimized not only to possess their own inherent capabilities through a radar, an S-band radar on board, 360 degrees capability, but also the SM-3, SM-6 interceptors. But they also linked into the Ballistic Missile Defense Organization hierarchy, giving additional coverage, additional capability, et cetera. What Iran did on April 14th was fired seven missiles at Nevatim Air Base, and five of them hit their target. The most heavily defended place on the planet, specifically geared to defend from Iranian ballistic missile threats. Seven missiles were fired, five hit their target. Now, the Iranians weren't looking to do damage. They had given, here's the other thing that people need to understand. The Iranians had provided at least 72 hours advance notice that they were going to do this attack. That was allegedly based upon a conversation between William Burns, the director of the CIA, who met with Iranian counterparts in the Middle East. And they had a conversation where Iran said, this is what we're going to do. And Burns said, as long as you don't kill civilians, do it. Now, there's two aspects of this. Even the dogs are upset by this this revelation. But and I apologize for that. It's daytime and my neighbors are walking their dogs and my dogs go crazy. But there's two aspects to the Burns meeting. One is the advance notice that Iran gave, which means that the United States and Israel were able to maximize the efficiency of their anti-ballistic missile system. And two, you heard me right. William Burns, the director of the CIA, gave Iran the green light to attack Israel. What kind of friend does that? Not only that, the United States told Israel that while we will help defend you against Iranian ballistic missile attack, we will not participate in any Israeli response against Iran. You are on your own. And the reality is that Iran cannot carry out a meaningful military strike against Israel without American participation. So it ties Iran's hands. So despite all this, and then the other thing is the Iranians publicly announced that they were launching their attack by unleashing drones, slow-moving, noisy drones that said, here we come, for 5 hours. And it allowed the United States, Great Britain, and France to put the aircraft up, to get everything queued up, ready to rock. Despite all this, Iran fired 7 missiles at Nevatim Air Base, and 5 of them hit their target. This is a game-changing event, because what it told the Israelis is that Iran can reach out and touch you anytime, anywhere, with overwhelming force, and there's nothing you can do to defend yourself, that you no longer have deterrence superiority, that Israel no longer has a blank check to do whatever it wants in the Middle East, that if Israel ever again attacks Iran, whether it's in Iran or Iranian interests in nations surrounding Iran, that the Iranian retaliation will be immediate and overwhelming. It flipped the script on deterrence supremacy. Iran now holds deterrence supremacy, not only against Israel, but against the United States, because the reason why the United States betrayed their Israeli ally in this fashion is that they were told by Iran that should the United States participate in this attack, that every American base in the region would be leveled by Iranian ballistic missiles. And the United States knew, based upon their 2020 experience with Al-Asad Air Base, the retaliation for the assassination of Qasem Soleimani, the United States knew that Iran could deliver on that promise.
And all of these things, all these realities were known before April 14th. Only now they become ultra real because of the action Iran took, the decisive action they took. But what's amazing, Scott, is they went over the heads of the Israelis in the sort of deconfliction line with the United States. So that means Iran is a bona fide regional power now, on the same level or higher than Saudi Arabia or Israel, for that matter, because really Israel it then becomes a kind of subordinate in this communication between Iran and Washington. They're basically bargaining with Washington directly, saying, hey, this is what we're going to do. We're going to give you warning. So this is what a normative state actor does. This is what a superpower or a regional power does. Israel, on the other hand, has been acting like a rogue entity in the last 6 months, especially. So in a way, does this raise Iran's profile in the eyes of the strategists in Washington? What do you think?
Well, I think Iran's profile has been already raised in the eyes of the strategists in Washington, D.C. I think we need to differentiate between military specialists and politicians. Military specialists have not long known that Iran holds regional superiority over everybody, including Israel. This is why when the Global Hawk drone was shot down by Iran over the Strait of Hormuz, when Donald Trump was saying that he wanted to launch a retaliation strike against Iranian air defense systems on Iranian territory, the military told him, don't do it, because you will begin a cycle of escalation that will result in our ships being sunk, our air bases being destroyed, and then we will have to try to accumulate power to project it into Iran but Iran has ballistic missile capability that can touch us before we get there. We may not be able to get there. And even once we do get there, there's no guarantee that we will win. And this could unfold over years. So why don't we just call it a day and move on? And Donald Trump made the right decision at that point in time. Of course, he spun it a little bit differently, that he didn't do it out of humanitarian concerns. But the reality is the U.S. military told him, don't do it. The Israeli military, I used to work very closely with Amman, the military intelligence, and particularly with the technical intelligence part that dealt with ballistic missiles. And they're very good. They're very good at understanding the capabilities of their threat, of the potential adversaries. And therefore, based upon that, I can surmise that they continue to be very good and that they have briefed their leadership that the Iranian missile capabilities are superior than to the Israeli ability to defend against them. The problem is Israeli politicians didn't want to hear that, because if you hear that, then you have to act on it, absorb it one way or another. And that would preclude you from carrying out the aggressive policies that that Israel is known for. For instance, assassinating Iranian military people on the soil of a sovereign Syrian state, to bomb an Iranian consulate in violation of international law. Israeli politicians believed that they had deterrent supremacy, that Iran was cowed over decades of inaction. Iran would not act on this. And to be honest, the Israelis had every right to believe this. I mean, yes, it was the American assassination of Qasem Soleimani that caused the reaction, but the Iranians, the Israelis have been assassinating Iranian nuclear scientists for decades now. They've been blowing up Iranian critical infrastructure. They've been killing Iranian soldiers and generals in Syria, in Lebanon, in Iraq for years with no Iranian meaningful retaliation. So if I were briefing the Israeli leadership, political leadership, I would say, based upon past precedent, there's a 90% chance that Iran will not respond to this attack on the consulate. I mean, that's not an illogical assumption based upon the lack of declaratory retaliation or declaratory deterrent policy by Iran. But this time they guessed wrong. Iran said, no, now you've gone too far. And now Iran has put a declared deterrence policy statement on the table. And it's as clear as day. Any attack against Iran, either whether it's in Iran or outside of Iran, will result in an immediate overwhelming retaliation against those who attacked us. This is the kind of declaratory policy that Iran could have benefited from a month ago, because it might have stopped the Israelis from carrying out the attack on the consulate. But now it's crystal clear. And yet, Israeli politicians continue to believe that Iran's bluffing, that Iran won't carry out this kind of act because their war cabinet just approved an Israeli strike against Iran. Now, the Israelis are trying to couch the strike in terms of just a demonstration. It's not a real strike. We're just doing it for pride or whatever. But what part of Iran's statement, any attack against Iran, any attack, meaning Iran will not brook anything. And the Israelis are gambling that Iran is bluffing, that Iran won't retaliate with overwhelming force. So we'll find out how serious the Iranians are about their deterrence policy. We'll find out if this is just posturing and bluff on the part of Israel, and ultimately they won't attack because they'll receive a phone call from Joe Biden at the last second and bend to the will of America. This provides political cover for Israeli leadership, who otherwise might be called weak. They can say, we wanted to do this, but America held us back and America was threatening to withhold aid and we can't do that. We have to yield, and they'll transfer responsibility to the United States. But we're in a very dangerous time where, you know, there's a sort of a high stakes game of chicken taking place, and who's going to blink first.
Arguably, Scott, we're in a much more risky situation now than we were on Friday. If you think about it, no, let's say Israel does retaliate, that I agree with you, Scott, that would be the best face saving out for Netanyahu and the Israeli government. If Joe Biden made that call, that would work for everybody, I think, in politically anyway. But let's suppose Israel does retaliate. Are there any Western countries dumb enough to be an accessory to that? And we're talking about the United States, the British, the French, the Jordanians are in a very difficult position, aren't they, by helping to bring down projectiles over their airspace over the weekend. The King Abdullah II is really treading on thin ice because of that move. What do you see? Let's just say, theoretically, Scott, if Israel retaliates, even if it's a symbolic retaliation, but it does elicit an Iranian response, where are we going to be at that point, Scott?
Well, first of all, you have to understand that Jordan indicated that the reason why it behaved the way it did is that Iran violated its territorial integrity by sending missiles over. And Jordan's right. The Iranians didn't get permission to fly over Jordan. And so Jordan had every right to defend its airspace. So that's point one. What will Jordan do when Israel flies its airplanes over Jordanian airspace towards Iran? Will they shoot down the Israeli aircraft with the same vigor that they shot down the Iranian drones? That'll be the true test of the alleged impartiality of the King of Jordan. The answer is no. He will open up his airspace and let the Israeli aircraft fly, because the Israelis have threatened him in the past, and they will continue to threaten him that they will destroy every single Jordanian air defense system out there and everything else if Jordan dares oppose them. But then they have to fly into Iraq. Iraq's a different thing. Iraq will, of course, oppose it, not give permission. But Iraq is powerless to do this because America is the one who operates over Iraqi airspace. The United States can't refuel, can't provide any intelligence assistance. So American aircraft will effectively have to stand down, clear Iraqi airspace, and let the Israelis fly through, a deconfliction, so to speak. But now the Israeli aircraft, remember, they don't have the ability to refuel. They will try to project some refueling capacity over Iraq, but they become vulnerable to Iranian air defense and Iranian fighter aircraft. The Israelis would have to put a permanent combat air patrol over Iraq to protect their refuelers. And this is difficult to do because that also requires refueling capacity, and Israel only has limited refueling capacity. So whatever strike they do will have to be a very small number of aircraft. But even with this refueling, the aircraft will have very limited operational parameters that they can operate on inside Iran, depending on what they're trying to strike, meaning that there's not going to be a great deal of maneuverability. It's going to be an in and out operation. If anything goes bad, they could very well get shot down. And here's the problem for Israel. Right now, even though the concept of technological supremacy has been burst when it comes to defense, they have the F-35I, which is supposed to be the most advanced fighter in the world. They have advanced F-15Es, strike fighters. What happens when Israel loses a couple of these? What happens when Iran shoots some of them down? It not just bursts the Israeli bubble, but the American bubble, who the Americans are saying the F-35 is the ultimate aircraft. And if F-35s go down, this will be problematic for Israel. But basically what I outlined is a very risky operational parameter that Israel won't be able to apply with any significance or substance over Iran itself proper. Iran is a heavily defended airspace. It would be very risky. So Israel will seek to strike a minor target, maybe an Iranian oil platform in the Persian Gulf, maybe Kish Island, Fish Island, something of that nature, something that demonstrates Israel's resolve without doing any damage. Now the question is, what does Iran do? Because there's no doubt that this strike will be very limited in scope and scale. In fact, I would imagine that it would be telegraphed to the Iranians, not the specific location, but the fact that this is not an all-out attack. Don't worry. Vladimir Putin, who considers Iran a close ally, has already made a phone call to the Iranian leadership, asking them not to behave precipitously. He's not telling them not to do anything. He's just saying, we need to calm this thing down. Will the Iranians listen? My inclination is to believe, yes, they would, for the following reasons. Russia's hosting the BRICS summit in October. Iran's strategic priority is not war with Israel. Iran's strategic priority is normalization of relations with Gulf Arab states, creating a stable economic environment that better positions Iran to be a viable participant in whatever global economy is being shaped at the BRICS summit in Kazan, Russia in October. And Iran wants the Russians to advocate for their participation in this new global economy. In order to do that, Iran must convince the Russians that they are rational actors, that they aren't aggressively looking for a fight regardless of the justification for this. Remember, this is Vladimir Putin, who has eaten a lot of crow over the years because of his measured actions vis-a-vis Ukraine and the West. This is Vladimir Putin, who knows what it means to pay a price for choosing diplomacy over military options early on. And so you can't pull one over on him. You can't say you don't understand. He understands very well the pressures that Iran is under, and he's a smart enough man to articulate this and use his very able foreign ministry to articulate this. So I imagine that Putin will continue to put the pressure on Iran for Iran not to respond in overwhelming fashion against an Israeli strike. Weighing against this is the Iranian Revolutionary Guard Command and the conservative members of the Iranian theocracy. These are people who have themselves eaten crow for decades, told not to retaliate, not to do anything, and they finally had the opportunity to establish a strong deterrence policy and put Iranian deterrence superiority on the map. And now they're being asked to stand down and nullify that. And this will be a very, very difficult pill for them to swallow. So Iran's going to have some very interesting discussions over the course of the next few days. And to me, it's a coin flip which way they go. I wouldn't be able to tell you one way or the other, which I believe that logic tells me that they would take Putin's call and take it seriously. But I also understand the frustration of the Revolutionary Guard Command, which lost not only Qasem Soleimani, but three other senior officers in the consular attack and other officers. They've been told to suck it up and not overreact for decades. And this is their moment. They had their attack, and they couched the attack in very moderate terms, meaning they didn't go in with overwhelming power. They were just trying to demonstrate a capability. And they were told that by being soft on Israel early on, that demonstration of capability would be sufficient to hold Israel at bay. But now Israel isn't being held at bay, and they're going to turn to their leadership and say, now it's our turn. Let us do what we want to do. Let us do it how we want to do it. And that leadership's going to be in a quandary because both arguments are compelling.
Is it now possible, Scott, that Iran could actually take out the very facilities in Israel that Israel would use to launch an attack against Iran? I mean, is that also a reality here? Because they have demonstrated that they can touch these air bases. It's not a very big territory, Israel, so they have their target list. What about this strategically?
Legally, they would be allowed to do this because Article 51 of the United Nations Charter allows for preemptive self-defense. Meaning that you don't have to wait for the enemy to attack. You now just had a cabinet meeting, a war cabinet meeting that said we have authorized an Israeli response. And the Israelis have run consecutive annual war games where they talk about bombing Iran. They have said the kind of targets they would bomb, command and control, nuclear infrastructure, related to Iran's peaceful nuclear program, things of this nature. So Iran can say that there's an imminent threat from Israel that justifies preemptive attack under Article 51, concept of self-defense. And Iran would have every right now, the moment the cabinet met, finished, to launch an overwhelming strike against Israel's air bases, to take out the F-35s, the F-15s, to deny them the ability to use the runways, to attack command and control facilities, to attack leadership facilities. All of these are legitimate targets. I don't think Iran's going to do that. What I think Iran could do is what they've promised to do, that the moment the aircraft take off in Israel towards Iran, Iran will launch all of its missiles so that whatever surviving aircraft come back, there won't be any place for them to land. And they may not have command and control connectivity because their leadership may have been eliminated. This is what Iran has promised to do, a tenfold response to this. But again, that phone call from Putin may hold their hand on this, may stay their hand. And then, you know, then what does Iran wait for Israel, for the Israeli attack to manifest itself? Which, from a common sense perspective, if you receive the phone call from Putin, one way the phone call could go is that we will wait to see what Israel does.
At that point, could it get escalated immediately to the UN Security Council level? Because you've said Russia will be involved in that, China, United States. If the moment Israel retaliates, it would be a snap emergency meeting, wouldn't there?
I believe so, but I don't know. Russia could tell Iran to hold off until the Security Council meets and then hold that over the United States to get some sort of vote to condemn the Israeli actions. You know, now we're into politics and games. And what would Iran do? And again, I mean, the problem that we're facing here with that scenario is that that scenario takes Iran down the path of doing nothing. And while that provides political cover for the Iranian leadership, saying that they've yielded to political pressure, et cetera, it also puts them in a very bad position with a very powerful domestic constituency, which is the Revolutionary Guard Command. And so for that reason, to avoid that scenario, Iran may choose to retaliate, but Russia may tell them that if you respond with disproportional force, you know, you lose our diplomatic cover at the Security Council. We covered for you on this last attack, but we can't guarantee to cover for you if you choose to behave. So this is a very complicated scenario. There's nothing black and white about it. Again, because I believe Iran's strategic focus is regional stability and economic prosperity for the Iranian people, that the Iranian leadership will opt for a face-saving mechanism that avoids full-scale war with Israel, retains a level of deterrence, supremacy, or superiority, but keeps Iran gainfully engaged with the Russians, the Chinese, and others on BRICS. What Iran doesn't want to do is enter the room in Kazan as a pariah state, as a state called a troublemaker. Iran wants to walk into that room and say, we are a stable, reasonable power that is capable of dealing with the law-based order of the world. And like Vladimir Putin, we have shown an ability to take a step back and not react when legally we could have reacted out of the interests of, you know, regional security. So I'm hoping that's the direction Iran goes. But again, the Revolutionary Guard Command is a very powerful constituent that has a very legitimate grievance that they have been patient too long, and now's the time to bring the hammer down.
And quite prophetically, Scott, as you pointed out in your recent Substack piece in 2007, you made a address to the Jewish American Committee, and you were concerned at the time about Israel's behavior vis-a-vis its neighbors in Iran, that one day Iranian missiles would indeed rain down on Israeli territory. And I'm sure that wasn't a very popular thing at the time for you to say, but here we are, Scott, it's happened. And for the very reasons, I think, which you had outlined all those years ago. So that's quite an extraordinary thing. But really, Scott, I wanted to ask you, April 14th, must be the most significant sea change in the Middle East since October 2015, when Russia intervened in Syria, that did change the calculus of the region. Do you think this is taking a step even above and beyond that geopolitically?
Yeah, I think this is the beginning of the end of Israel's regional dominance. I think from this point on, Israel will at a minimum be deemed the equal of Iran. And because of Iran's, superior track record, Iran doesn't have the world turned against it anymore. I mean, the irony is at one point in time, the world was turned against Iran because of its nuclear program. Today, the world is turned against Israel because of its policies in Gaza. So I think we've seen that, but it goes beyond regional. As I wrote an additional article in my Substack I just published today called Checkmate, that's an extension of this, the missiles of April. And what I point out is what the Americans overlaid over Israel on October 14th or April 14th was basically a picture perfect theater ballistic missile defense system. It's the same kind of system that we assure our European allies will protect them from Russian missiles. It's the same system that we assure our Japanese and South Korean allies will protect them from North Korean missiles. It's the same system that we assure our Taiwanese allies and regional allies will protect them from Chinese missiles. And yet what the Iranians proved is that they can not only hit any target on the land, but they will sink any target at sea. This means American aircraft carriers. What protects American aircraft carriers? The same ballistic missile defense architecture that Iran just penetrated. This means that North Korea now, because they have similar capabilities, missile capabilities, is no longer worried about the U.S. missile deterrence. And the United States can't convince Japan and South Korea that this missile defense umbrella is infallible. You don't worry about it. It'll be there. It'll never fail. The Japanese and South Koreans are going, well, it failed in Israel. The Europeans are saying, wait a minute, you're telling us you can shoot down the Kinzhal and the Zircon, but you couldn't shoot down these Iranian missiles. Why should we trust you? Taiwan saying, whoa, time out. You're telling us you can handle these Chinese missiles, but you can't. They're going to sink your fleet. The fleet is supposed to be coming to our assistance. This changes everything. This puts America in checkmate globally. We have lost deterrence supremacy, not just Israel. And that's the game-changing moment here, because the United States has based everything, its current posture vis-a-vis the world in terms of military power projection, on the notion of the technological superiority of America's ballistic missile defense shield. And the Iranians just proved that it's not infallible. It can be defeated. The North Koreans have similar technology. The Chinese have similar technology. The Russians have similar technology. That means that America is vulnerable to all of its potential adversaries.
Heaven forbid, Scott, this opens the door to diplomatic talk and negotiations, maybe some dialogue in all of these different theaters rather than just threats and arming sides and so forth. I mean, is there a possibility that we could be entering that phase now based on what you've said?
It's the only way we enter that phase. And I'll show you from history. If you go back to the Cold War in the 1960s, the United States and the Soviet Union were engaged in a very dangerous and very expensive arms race, where we were both producing missiles at the same time we were producing anti-ballistic missile capability. And so as we developed new anti-ballistic missile capability, we had to develop new ballistic missile response to that. So that's how we got to multiple reentry vehicles, independently targetable reentry vehicles, maneuvering independently target reentry vehicles, and it became insane. So eventually the Russians and the Americans sat down, the Soviets and the Americans sat down and said, let's sign the anti-ballistic missile treaty. Let's just acknowledge that we can't build a perfect defense and that we're both now vulnerable to attack, mutually assured destruction. And since we know we're both going to die, we both won't fire missiles on each other. And now we begin the talks. It opened the door for the strategic arm limitation talks, which slowed down the growth of the weapons, limited the types of weapons. And then that led to the strategic arms reduction talks, the reduction of weapons, which, imperfect as it is, understand there's only 1,550 nuclear weapons, strategic nuclear weapons in the American arsenal today, deliverable. That's down from tens of thousands that we had during the Cold War. So arms control does work. And what we can talk about now in America's interfacing with the world, we can now start to sit down and talk with the Chinese from a perspective that doesn't include we're going to beat you up over Taiwan. We can talk to the Russians from a perspective that doesn't include we're going to create a Ukrainian proxy to destroy you. Or with North Korea, from that doesn't include the perspective, we'll launch a preemptive decapitation strike against your leadership. Because now those actions are suicidal. So now we have to sit down with the North Koreans and say, you exist. How do we peacefully coexist? We have to sit down with the Chinese and say, how do we resolve the Taiwan problem so that we both don't end up going to war against each other? We have to sit down with the Russians. It'll be in a post-Ukraine environment, but we'll have to sit down and say, how do we come up with that European security framework that you've been talking about? It changes the dynamic of the dialogue when America no longer operates under this assumption, presumption of technological supremacy, military supremacy. Now that America has been shown to be lesser militarily, it opens up the door for diplomatic solutions.